Maria is also one of the owners of Flathead Mortgage with Dave Boyd. And we want to welcome you here today because one of the things and one of the reasons why we wanted to do this is that Dave and I strongly believe in sharing information. We do not do this as a business, like we are mortgage brokers. We are not professional marketers, but yet we are professional marketers. So we wanted to share the information and knowledge that we've learned over the years. And I think the key point is that we are not perfect. Nobody is perfect. But we are here growing and trying to get better every day. So we want to share that information with you guys. And so, Dave, do you have anything?
Sure. So I've been a mortgage broker for 16 years, and occasionally I get a phone call from somebody who is asking me a question, and I'm thinking, why are they calling me to ask me this question? And it's because they think I know the answer to the question. So part of my branding is what people think of me and what people think of Black Diamond Mortgage. As you observe all of our guests, we're all in the same boat. So each of them has a story, each of them has a brand that has developed. And then Anoush is going to bring a lot of tools. So use your booklet, take some notes, and then anytime I go to something like this, if I can get one of these concepts or two and actually implement it or do it, then things get a lot better. So I encourage you to do the same.
Perfect. And that actually brings me to introduce our first speaker. So we have Anoush here that she is a marketing genius. And I will tell you what, I have not met as an intelligent of a girl as her. She is 20 years old. She graduated high school when she was 17. She graduated with honors. I don't know a lot of people that graduated when they were 17. I sure the heck did not. So, but we can take a lot of knowledge that she's going to bring to the table. And a cool thing is that she actually worked with a gentleman that out of California that has over 33 million followers combined over their social media platforms. So the reason I'm telling you that is because she knows her shit. So pay attention and I welcome Anoush.
Okay, I see
room is raising their hand. It's kind of what I expected. Now let me tell you why all of you should have raised your hand. Because you are your brand. Every single person here has a brand. If you have emotion, passion, if you have experiences, then you have a brand. Because, well, what is a brand? A brand is simply the perception of you, how you are perceived in the world. A brand is your values, a brand is your personality, a brand is why you love to do what you do, why you get up out of bed every morning. So I'd like to start by defining our terms. If you open your little booklet here, you'll also see in the bag that you got, Keep Calm and Mortgage On, that's a great one, there's a pen inside, so I really suggest you take that pen out because I'll have some spaces where you can write things down on later pages. So like I said, branding is the perception. It's the perception of you as an individual. Now marketing, on the other hand, is a completely different thing. It's actually a tool inside of branding. Here's another easy question for you guys. How many of you have spent any sort of time, energy, or money on marketing? Now everyone's hand is raised, right? Even I spent my fair share of money on marketing, okay? Let me tell you why that's an issue. Branding first, marketing second. If branding is your voice, then marketing is simply your megaphone. I feel like sometimes we get so excited carrying this megaphone around, this microphone, right? That we don't actually stop and think about what we're saying first. We love to be on a billboard, be in the newspaper, maybe a magazine or a commercial. We love to hand out flyers. But what are we actually saying? You see, if branding is the pull, marketing is the push. It's so easy to keep pushing things out to people, to new consumers, different ideas, different social media platforms. But is what you're pushing out bringing that pull? Are you actually going to pull people in through their emotion and through your passions? So that's what we're going to talk about a little more today. I'll give you a little more insight on how we can create that pull for branding. Now, another thing that I would like to touch on is the fact that branding lasts a lifetime while marketing lasts a moment. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm sure this is obvious. You know, if you're in a newspaper, maybe you're in it for a month. If you're on a billboard, you're on it for 6 months. If you hand out a flyer, that'll last a second until someone throws it away, right? I like to think of one of the most extravagant marketing advertisements that you can think of, which is Super Bowl commercials. We all know them, we all get them, okay? We all sit there and watch them, and they're great. They generate a lot of buzz. Billion-dollar companies spend millions and millions of dollars creating these commercials, right? But how long do those commercials really last? If they're good ones, they'll have some buzz for a couple days, maybe a week on the internet if they're lucky. But after that, we start to forget them, and we don't talk about them anymore. What do we remember? We remember that company's brand. Branding lasts a lifetime, marketing lasts a moment. You'll see on your page, I love this quote from Steve Forbes. It says, "Your brand is the single most important investment you can make in your business." And if that doesn't tell you something, then I don't know what does, because I don't think any of us are spending more time, energy, and money on branding versus marketing. And I think that's a switch that we should all work on changing. So if you flip to the next page, you'll see the golden circle. Now, have any of you ever heard of Simon Sinek?
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, we actually have a book here today, signed by him, and I'll share a little bit more later about how you can win this book. It's pretty cool. But he talks about the golden circle, the what, how, and why of your brand. He also has a TED Talk on it, which I really love. I suggest you all watch it. I wish I could play here today, but there's a QR code on the bottom of your screen, so if you ever want to watch it after this presentation, just scan that and you can see it. But let's talk about this golden circle. So first there's the what. I think that's pretty obvious. Everyone knows what their business is. What do you do? If you're a mortgage broker, you give home loans to people, right? How do you do it? Well, maybe you have a special software you use, maybe you have the best employees around, maybe you're all innovators. Maybe your product is user-friendly. Now, why do you do it? And this is the part that most people forget to mention when they're branding. It actually should be your focal point. I like that Simon uses the example of Apple. He says, well, here's how Apple could do it like most. He could just say, they could say the what and the how for their branding. They could say, you know, we're a computer company and our products are user-friendly, beautifully designed, and easy to use. That's not really inspiring. That's
passionate about what you do, your values in your business. So we're going to talk a little bit more about your whys. I suggest you all write down your what, hows, and whys. I think that's really helpful. You can think about that a little more. I would love to talk about some of yours later, so keep thinking on that. But now we're going to go to the next page and really talk about different brands so we can kind of relate their whys. I'm going to think of ours. Some big name brands we know, I already said Apple, think different. We got Coca-Cola, spreading and sharing the happiness, right? Everyone knows the images of the people laughing and smiling as they're giving each other pop cans, right? They even did that campaign where on the bottle they said, share a Coke with, and some names. Subaru, love, is what makes a Subaru. Now, if I blanked out all of these brands, if we pretended we didn't know them for a second, would you think love is what makes a blank a car manufacturer? I sure wouldn't. Would you think spreading and sharing happiness is a soda company? That's not the first thing that would come to mind for me. So it's not about the what, and it's not about the how. These billion-dollar brands are talking about their why they do what they do. And that's creating a reaction that we all remember. I'm going to share an example with you that actually happened this weekend. Now, mom has a friend, her name is Carla, she's amazing, and she actually owns a boutique furniture store in Columbia Falls. Now, Carla's been trying to generate some buzz lately, and my mom's a creative gal, so she was helping her with an advertisement. She was making some flyers for Carla. And I go over there and I see what she's doing, and my mom says, well, what do you think? And it says, Monaco, furniture and decor, with a great picture next. And me being the brutally honest person I am, I say, Mom, I hate it. And let me tell you why I said that. I know Carla. And I know how much passion and drive and blood, sweat, and tears she has put into that boutique furniture store. And that little flyer didn't show that at all. It was great. It looked exactly like how everyone else's would have. But it didn't tell me something about Carla. It didn't tell me something that would create a reaction at me. A reaction of trust, of loyalty, of credibility, of interest, maybe curiosity. So I thought, okay, I better practice what I preach, everyone. So I asked my mom, what's Carla's why? I don't know, Noosh, stop it, what are you talking about? No, what's her why? Why does she do what she do? Why did she start her business? Why does it exist in the first place? Well, she says, you know, I think she loves just finding treasures, finding unique things. You know, she's a very sweet-spirited person. Just digging through stuff, it gives her peace. She loves to find unique things. That's all. I said, okay, perfect. Why don't you say, find your piece. P-I-E-C-E, like a piece of furniture. Now, I'm not saying that's the best idea ever. I'm not even saying she should use it. But I got her to start thinking, okay, let's add some emotion to this. Let's add some passion and some connection. Now it didn't say Monaco, furniture, and decor. It said Monaco, furniture, and decor. Find your piece. Well, I don't even own my own house. I'm not really a furniture girl, but gosh, I want to find my piece. All right? So I really like that example, and it really just, the more you write things down, the more you start to think, how can you make that connection? Let's get local. You know, I want to talk about small businesses in the Valley, and if you think any of them have done a good job, what you've learned from them, I'd love to ask you guys another question. Are there any small businesses that you have learned from in branding, maybe that you look up to, that you would like to share? I'll start. I think that one brand that I like is Sweet Thieves, you know, not just because it's well-known and not just because I love ice cream, but because they're consistent with their marketing. Every time I walk in, I see the bright colors, they always have that artwork. Every time I look at their social media, they have the consistent aesthetic. So that's why I think that I could learn something from Sweet Thieves. And I'd love if anyone here could share anything that they maybe learned or could learn from a local brand. Anyone want to start us off? Yes!
I feel like I've been really impressed with Sacred Waters.
Yep. Sacred Waters.
Yeah. They capture the Montana vibe. They capture the spirit of people getting together in a fun place. And they invite other people to do social media posts and tag them.
Mm-hmm. I love that. So she talked about inclusion, right? They invite other people to do things. She talked about share their values time and time again. It's important to identify your niche. Who is your niche? Who is your audience? I feel like sometimes, like I said, we got so caught up with this megaphone in our hands and all the tools we could possibly use for marketing, we try to spread it to everyone and everywhere. But if you do that, you're going to fall through the cracks. And so finding your niche, finding who actually wants to do business with you, is really important. I'd love if someone would share maybe what their niche is in their business, what they think their niche is. Yes?
I help digital entrepreneurs who are impact-driven, making $10,000 to $30,000 a month, scale their business, and want to speak at those events.
So you help people, you help business entrepreneurs speak at events?
I help them scale their business.
Scale their business.
I help them make $1 million business.
All right, so that's your niche. Your niche is big-scale entrepreneurs, right? So you're not going to, you know, put an ad in the... Right, exactly. Right, so he knows his niche. He knows exactly who he needs to be targeting. You know, I like to use the example of hashtags. I like to think I know a little bit about social media. Everyone knows who hashtags, what hashtags are, right? So when you're creating a post, instead of going hashtag Instagram, hashtag viral, hashtag funny, right? Those are so broad. Those are going to reach way too many people, probably all over China and India, right? You want to go hashtag Flathead Valley, hashtag finance tips, hashtag Montana real estate, depending on what you do, right? So those hashtags are going to move your post to specific people that already are seeing that content, that already are interested in that content. Or else you're going to get your finance tip post on a 12-year-old's Instagram page and, well, that doesn't do much for you, okay? So, I wrote down everyone equals no one. If you are trying to build your brand upon everyone, you're going to get no one because, again, you're simply going to fall through the cracks. So, again, with your values, it's important to share those, like I said. Sometimes it can feel hard to share your values with your customers and plaster them all over. But that feeling of authenticity between you customer is what's going to create that reaction, that motion, and that passion. So how can you share your values? Well, maybe you can sponsor a certain event. Maybe you're an advocate for the environment and you show that through your products. I wonder what other ways you can share your values. Does anyone have any values here today that they would like to share with their business and maybe they already do? Yes.
You know, some of that is, I mean, there's business values and then there's also your personal values as well. Mm-hmm. Depending on how deep you're willing to go with that, you know, it can be pictures of your family, your children, your grandchildren, your spouse, you know, but it shows that you have a sense of family values and also others that have that as well, they relate to you in a greater, I feel like I relate to people like that in a greater passion. I'm a grandfather and father, and so, you know, me, that speaks volumes about a business. If someone is willing to take it a little bit, not necessarily expose your entire life, but you know, on your page you have stuff about your staff, about their families, and events that go on with them. So it's not just, you know, you're showing a value of creating a good environment, work environment, and a, you know, healthy environment in your work purpose.
Perfect. I love that. So basically, let me recap in case anyone didn't hear. What he said is he loved when people share their personal values, their family, their work environment, their staff, what their staff loves to do. He talked about being relatable to your customer. And that's really important key of all of this and your values and your branding. Maybe you're a family guy, like he said. Maybe you love a certain sport. Maybe you can connect with someone over golf or tennis or track. Maybe you can connect with someone because you both have a family member in the military. These are all things that you can share with people that will get a relatability aspect out of you. Because right now, just when you stand here, I don't know anything about any of you. I don't know if you know you have certain aspects of your life that I would greatly relate to, that we would hit it off. You have to share that stuff with your consumers, with your brand, with the right audience. So thank you for sharing. I love that. That's perfect. And now the last thing I want to talk about is your whys. Why, again, do you get out of bed in the morning? Why is your business even in existence? exactly what's going to cause that loyalty and that connection with our customer. So, if some of you would like to share your why, this is the book Start With Why by Simon Sinek, who created the Golden Circle, and it's actually signed by him, which is really cool. So, whoever shares their why will have a chance to win this book at the end. So I would love if some of you would share your why. We all get to learn a little bit about you, about your business, and we all learn from it. Who wants to start out? Yes.
Okay. We have a family business. It's locally owned by my husband and I, and our grown children, four of them, work for our company. So our why is to be the local experts, family owned, and to build a legacy company so our children can stay in the Flathead Valley.
What is your company?
Pardon me?
What is your company?
Oh, Tamarack Insurance.
Tamarack Insurance. So she talked about building a legacy in the Flathead Valley. I love that. That's great. And maybe what could you say to your customers? What transformation would you give your client? Do you have a clear offer of transformation for your client? Maybe they can build their own legacy in Flathead Valley through you.
Right. Exactly. Because we do all types of insurance, so you can truly protect everything. And we protect what you can't afford to lose.
I love that. We protect what you can't afford to lose. So immediately that sparks that emotional connection. They're protecting me. I don't want to lose something, and they can protect that. So that's great. You know, they're not saying, we're the number one, you know, insurance agent in the Flathead Valley, or we have the best prices. They're saying, we can protect. We don't want to lose. Awesome. Does anyone else have anything they'd love to share about their why? Yes.
Mine's a little deeper. I'm not deeper than any deeper guy. I just don't want to trigger anybody. But when I was two, my parents were divorced. My father was a severe alcoholic. He used to beat my mom. She got remarried when I was four, and my stepfather was a monster. He would tell me pretty much every day how worthless I was. And no matter how much success I seemed to have in school, on the field, or in my community, it was just never enough to get my father to ever pay attention to me. And so I fell into like addiction and violence. At the age of 23, I ended my life. I was super embarrassed and ashamed. I was like, I'm so worthless, I can't even heal myself. And so I hid that inside for forever. And then a few years, 4 years later, my best friend ended up taking his life. And the kicker was, he called me about a month before, and he left me a voicemail that I never answered and never returned. And so my message, and why I built the speaker training business, because I believe that your message is your message. And so I just took it upon myself to go out and help leaders feel vulnerable enough and powerful to share their story on the platform that will influence the world. And I believe through that, I can help them stop freeing themselves. So that's my goal.
Wow. Well, thank you for being authentic and sharing that part, that aspect of your why. I'll recap a little bit. He said that he had struggles growing up. You know, he fell into addiction. And even his friend committed suicide. But that is why he started his business, is because he wants to tell everyone that what they're saying is important, right?
Your
message is your message. That's amazing. I love that. That's perfect. Yes, Grant.
So I am a firm believer that every business has their why, but that each person within that business also has their why. And we're the experts in real estate finance, and we absolutely want to empower people to home ownership. But my why is not 100% the same as Black Diamond, because I mean, I was greatly impacted with my own purchase. And having a home and the safety of a home is super important. And that's like that protection, that safety is my why. And I just encourage you all that even if you're not a business owner or you are a business owner, whatever it is, like dig deep and figure out your why. And my niche is totally different than Dave's. I am a triathlete, he's a mountaineer. But I interact in my niche and he interacts in his niche. So, but we own the business together. So we're gonna be different,
not know this, but they're going to be voting on the best why, just so you know. So you have some time to think about it. We'll give you some time, but Dave and I had the opportunity to listen to Simon Sinek this last fall, and it is his real signature.
Woo!
I guarantee it. I was there, and he's amazing, and Start With Why is great. So I want you to really think about your why, because these three will be voting on the best why. All right. Okay. So I'm going to start with that. We have Matt, Kelly, and Don here. And do you guys know these guys yet? Do you know them at all?
They will.
They will. All right. So we're going to start out with the simple, I want each one of them to answer their why. And who would like to go first? All right.
I'm the president of Freedom Bank, started the bank from scratch in 2005. My father was a banker and I was very proud of him and what he did. And I saw the impact that he had on people and businesses and the community. My why is I want to carry that on. I care about people, I care about businesses. And my dream is to help other people realize their dreams.
My name is Kelli Trontel, vote left. I was an owner and founder of Recluse and Whitefish, which was a self-serve frozen yogurt and coffee shop. And as y'all know, life changes, there's seasons, and we either sink or swim. And so today I'm a single mom raising two beautiful children, and my heart is to just encourage specifically, talking about the niche, women to find the faithfulness of, my faith is important to me, so finding the faithfulness of God when life threatens to take you out. So that is my why. And just like you were saying, my dad greatly influenced me. He loved people. He's no longer here, but that was one thing that he had always told me was love God, love people, and you're going to be okay, Kelly. And so just loving people, and that's it. How can I love and serve people?
Hi everyone, I'm Matt, Arnold-Ladensack. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Clydesdale Outpost. We're a new boutique guest ranch experience with Clydesdale horses up the 93. I would say my personal why is I would have been a fifth generation firefighter. So helping people is something that I have ingrained in my blood and body. But I would say the big why of what we are as the Outpost is just a place for dreamers, adventurers, and doers. Obviously, Clydesdales are massive horses. They're very powerful, but also very gentle. So we hope to create like this amazing, magical experience for people where they can heal and just kind of go out and adventure.
I hear it calling me. They like helping people. Who likes helping people? Right? That's what we do. Now, have you guys ever been in a conversation with someone and literally you're not able to talk? But, yeah, right? But they literally, you hear from other people, oh my gosh, I had the best conversation with Maria. And I'm thinking, I didn't even say anything. But that person really enjoyed the fact that I was. You need to listen to your customers because that will actually help them. All right, Donna, I'm going to start with you on a little bit of the nitty gritty. All right, so I heard a little bit of your story that you started in a trailer because you didn't have a building. But what prompted you to start Freedom Bank?
Well, it was the why that I talked about earlier. And I didn't really realize it at the time that I was an entrepreneur. Now I've turned into like a serial entrepreneur. I have a software company that I started as well. But the main reason is that I've been in banking and I really enjoyed it. And I loved the freedom that I had to make the choices that I needed to, whether the bank was going to be successful or not. I understood that the bank I was with, the elderly owner, was planning on selling the bank. And I didn't want to work for someone else. So that's when I took the big leap together an application through FDIC to start a bank. I did it without any consultants, no attorneys, nothing. And when I had to go to this, I called the state commissioner and asked her when I could send my application in, and she goes, like, who's your attorney? And I'm like, I don't have an attorney. She goes, Don, you have to have an attorney. But anyway, my whole reason for starting Freedom Bank is I wanted my own freedom, and I wanted to create freedom for others. I wanted to help people take their dreams and ambitions and turn them into reality and build a business that hopefully has transitional value to it. And that's one thing I'll talk about a little bit later today on what I think it's important for a business owner to be thinking about from the very beginning is how do you get out, or do you get out, and what happens to your business, like you're talking about, you want to build a legacy for your family. And that's great motivation, it's a great vision, but at some point, you may have to realize that your children may not want that same dream. But in the process, you created that opportunity. And they can take, you know, I just tell people, if, you know, indecision is a decision. And I think you just need to move down the path, even though you may not know exactly where you plan on ending up, just to head down that path. And you'll find that there's going to be a fork in the road. And you'll take one of them, and maybe it's the right one, and maybe it's not. If it's not, back up. Take the other fork, and there'll be additional forks throughout your life. But if you're not constantly leaning forward and moving forward, you will never run into those forks that can be a life-changing experience.
So that actually ties into the sign that you had on your trailer. You gotta start somewhere. So what I'm hearing you say is, you gotta start somewhere. You can't just sit down. Like, you gotta keep moving forward. I think that's awesome. All right, now, what, I wanna talk to you, Matt. Now, what separates you from other local lodging experiences? Because you have a really unique thing going on, and you have a lot of followers. You catapulted on social media. So what makes you different and unique, really to your why, that you can share with these guys?
I think what specifically makes us unique is our bookability aspect of things. Like, a lot of Dune Ranches and more established businesses, it's a little bit more difficult to book. So we've kind of collaborated, like, we've created a property management system where we can book very simply, like a hotel, but still give people that guest range experience that they're looking for. So people coming to Montana don't have to plan, you know, 3 months to 6 months and even a year in advance. They can just go online and book it. But we also incorporate the horse aspect of it, where they can stay on the Stillwater River, they can do a carriage ride, they can do a horseback ride. But I think that's really what makes us different. And then, of course, the whole aspect with Clydesdale horses. I mean, what's amazing about Clydesdales is that they've built America. Like, they've built the world, basically, before we had these big machines. So there's this really neat nostalgic point, not just with, you know, horses in general, but like when they come, people come to the barn, like older people who've been around them growing up, like the smell and just like that culture. There is a very amazing significance to that. And keeping that going, keeping bloodlines going is so neat. And I think what really draws people, especially around the springtime, is when we have our foals and people want to just come and see the babies. Like, we've put it out there, and like 4,000 people will try to show up. It's absolutely insane. And then we'll limit it to like 100 to 200 people with free tickets to come. And then what's absolutely crazy is people try to sell those free tickets. So it kind of like spirals into this like black market. So anyway, I think people are drawn to the horses, but also the bookability. And I think you have to kind of go with modern times, but also incorporate the tradition.
Now, Kelli, you are a social media guru, and you actually help a lot of different brands. So how do you help those brands, and how do you help them figure
covered a lot of that, which was so good. I think she hit it. I have it in this book here. And I didn't even ask the who. I know that's an honor, but like, who are you? And that can change as seasons change, but I'm still that person, loving people no matter what. So even if you have a failed business or I don't want to call it failed because there's always experience and it's a win, but that doesn't change. Disappointment had to change my position on loving people and keeping me going forward. So it's really, who are you? What are you at the core? And going back to people and the why, and that's something that no one can do for you. You really do have to do that work. There's someone that I love, Gary Vaynerchuk, and he talks about doing that 15 hours of homework that only you can do. You can't hire me or anyone else to say, hey, figure this out. Like, what is my why? It really needs to come from you, because when disappointments come, that's what's going to keep you going. And it's thinking long term, not short term. Short term is, that's harder to deal with. So, and what is it in the morning that's going to wake you up? Is it your alarm clock or is it your purpose and your calling? So figuring that out and guiding them with those questions that you were asking, but just encouraging them to do that homework and guiding them in those, asking those questions.
Now, Donna, I want to elaborate a little bit on you got to start somewhere. Now, do you feel that you've been able to betray that to your current staff about the same ethics that you have and the passion that you have behind starting somewhere with your business? Because I want to know, do you feel like it's a good mentality to have when you're an entrepreneur? And how can you help people to understand that more, to have that mentality, that you do have to start somewhere?
Well, I love that song, you know, Be Humble. I'm president of the bank, but I'm no different than anybody else that works with me or any of my customers. I have feelings. I can be happy, I can be sad, I can be hurt, I can be motivated. It's just that we play different roles in the bank. As president, I have my role, but it doesn't mean I'm any better than the teller. We have to work together, because if they don't do their job well, then it's not a good reflection on me. If I'm not a good reflection for the bank, then they won't have anything to do because we won't have any customers. So when we started out in a trailer, it's very humble. The windows were cracked, the panes between the two were fogged up, wires hanging out of the ceiling. And there was just three of us in the trailer. And I remember an instance, it was pretty funny. Like all trailer houses, we had issues. We had mice. And we also had frozen pipes. And one day, I always carried overalls with me. Always wear a suit and tie. But the pipes froze, so I had to crawl out underneath the trailer and put heat tape on the pipes and try and warm them up to thaw them out so the girls could go to the bathroom. And they reach out to the door and go, "Don, you have a customer." So I get up, peel off my overalls and step behind my desk and get the job done. And then when it came time, to build the bank building that we're in now, it was bigger than what I started out with, but I talked with a couple different people and said, take all your risk up front. If you're going to do something, do it right the first time. It doesn't mean that you just jump in blindly. Do your research, do your homework, know exactly what you're planning to do, but then when you decide to pull the trigger, give it everything that you have and keep your focus. And that was the other kind of people to say them, and I won't allow them to say the word assume. Those two things. But because what I've found is when businesses say we have the best customer service, they really don't. They just want to. So rather than say it, in my opinion, the best thing you can do is do the best customer service and have your customers tell other people. That's the best marketing I know of is through word of mouth with existing customers.
I'm actually going to sneak to this side now. Change it up a little bit. All right, Kelli. We see a lot of authenticity in your brand, in your personal brand. How has that changed and propelled your career? How has that changed and propelled my career? What I've learned is people connect with pain and honesty. And so when I had the right to do this, we were very open and honest about that. We moved here from Nashville, Tennessee to open up a frozen yogurt coffee shop. I had never done that before. I loved coffee. You know, frozen yogurt was fun. But the purpose, again, was in the people bit. And I would always just tell my employees, like, we're so much more than frozen yogurt and coffee. And we want to just come here and love on people. Create an environment where dads and daughters can have their dad and daughter dates and having hard days, whatever. This is just frozen yogurt coffee was the vehicle to get people in so we could love our community and provide a space for whatever they need to be doing, building their dreams and all of that. So I was very open and honest about that. That was like our top highlight. We're so much more than frozen yogurt coffee and then the line changed a bit. We are in a small town, and we're just open and public. And so, rather than hiding, which I kind of felt like I wanted to do, just hide for a while, I just share life, and not in a negative, but just here's the drama, but just this is what happened. And so, I think just being honest with life. And loss. I mean, it isn't just divorce for me. I've lost my dad and my mom and my younger sister in the last 10 years. So I'm the only one living in my family photo growing up. And so just sharing that. People connect with pain and loss and disappointment. And I want to use that to encourage people to not give up, you know, to keep going. You have a plan, a purpose, and a calling on your life. So people have resonated with that. So it's scary, it's absolutely scary to just put that stuff out there, and it's not for everybody, but I wouldn't be afraid to be honest and just share the highs and lows of your business, you know, in an appropriate way for your brand. But my branding, I know the personal and business, I'm kind of running more in that personal branding lane right now. But I still think that as a business, you can share, you know, the messed up cinnamon bun that happened that morning. Like, you know, like, you're not the perfect baker, or things happen, or I forgot to turn the oven to the right temperature. Like, those kinds of things make you human. And I think that's very important. People support people. So you can have a ton of banks in town, and they're going to go with that one that's human, and that they're seen, they're valued, they're loved. So I think definitely the personal branding and the business goes hand in hand. So as scary as it is, I think just sharing some of that human side, just try it. And I guarantee like you'll have another comment or more likes. People relate to humanness, so we don't have to be perfect all the time. I was actually just chatting with a gal yesterday, and she said that same exact thing. If her story helps one other person, then her being vulnerable will be absolutely worth it. So try it. Just start slow, start small, whatever you need to do, but just try it. You're gonna hit at least one person, I guarantee it. All right, Matt. How are you able to build your brand into your daily content and be consistent with it?
So social media for me, because I run all of our social media, is just something that comes natural. And I think what is really important is that if you see something and you like feel that magic feeling, you're like, wow, I should really share that. Do it, and do it right then. Because I don't wait, I don't like have a schedule. You know, there's so many different tools and platforms that you can use to schedule your social media. I just like legit go to Wi-Fi and get it uploaded. And it doesn't have to be perfect. You don't have to have all the right hashtags, but you have to have something that's going to help you find your tribe and help them find you. But it shouldn't be very difficult. It's more of like this innate gut feeling that you should have. And like, why are you sharing this? And why do you think your people are going to like it? And what's kind of fun about that?
Speaking of tools, do you have any tools though? Because you're very quick to produce, but do you have anything that you want to give these guys to use as tools?
So I kind of have an advantage because I went to film school. So utilizing like just different tools in general as equipment, I have just, you know, a DSLR camera, just very basic things. But I think quality is really important. I do think like, yeah, getting something up there quick is great, but I think it should be quality because people are flipping through their story very fast now, you know, TikTok or scrolling very quick. So it has to capture the eye, so it has to be something of quality. As far as scheduling tools, I don't utilize any of those. I don't really utilize any, like, I don't know, specific tools in general other than just the platforms themselves. And I think that a lot of platforms are getting away from those tools that help you kind of do that. And even, you know, like, you can do like hashtag. I used to always go to this hashtag, I forget what it's called. It's an app where you can like type in a word, like Clydesdale, you know, and it will auto-populate like all these different hashtags that you can incorporate. But I think it looks kind of silly if you just do too many. So being more specific for your posts is really important.
I want to add in that having a millennial in your business may help you on your social media platforms. All right, Don, you've talked a lot. I feel like you've gotten pretty deep. But I want to know what advice you would give to others when developing their brand.
I think you have to be sincere and feel good about it. Personally, that way it's easy to support and promote it. The other thing I think is consistency, and not just in the content or what you're trying to pass along, but more in the message, the vibe, the feeling that you want to try and create for your customers and non-customers that will then turn them into customers. And Anusha was talking about, you know, how important it is, you know, for people to understand what your why is and your how. All of it is very important. So I think it's being consistent, and again, I think being honest and humble, I think, makes a big difference. Because what you, at least for me, what I want to try and build is trust in a relationship. I don't really want to have, you know, like a wham bam, see you later kind of a relationship. And I'm not everything to everybody, just like you pointed out. I understand that as I'm the smallest bank in the Flathead Valley, and I'm actually kind of proud of that. You know, we have a billboard that says, dream big, bank small. And I don't have to be the biggest, best, fastest, whatever. I just want to make sure that what I do makes a difference, you know, in my life, in my community's life, and my customers' lives. And we try and touch people. I don't care if they bank with us or not. I treat everybody exactly the same. It doesn't matter to me what color they are or what sex they are. Or it just doesn't have anything to do with how I think and feel. And I think that consistency helps me in growing my business.
Now, I don't think you're on social media a whole bunch. Do
Do you enjoy that, or do you feel like you miss out on social media?
I am so busy. If I ever get on Facebook and I start looking at things, pretty soon like 20 minutes or half an hour's gone by. I haven't gotten anything done. So I'm like the opposite, which is fine. I've seen a lot of very successful people that stick to the simple things in life, and they just do them consistently, and they understand where they want to go and how they want to get there. My wife does social media, so if I need to learn about the floods in Yellowstone or something like that, I mean, or something's happened with our family. So I get it that way, but I just don't want to spend my time on that. That's one thing that we all have the same amount of, 24 hours in a day. And how you choose to spend those 24 hours kind of determines who you are, but also how far you're going to get. I know, like Vic is an example, we've done some work together. I mean, the guy is just go, go, go. I mean, he gets 25 hours out of every day. And I don't know if I really want to do that either. His quality of life is another important aspect of it. But,
Kelli, what do you have any tools, first of all, for all the clients that you work with?
I don't use any scheduling tools either. What you see is, Kelli just wrote that. Kelli just thought that. I'm live in the moment and share, what's going on. As far as managing social media for other companies, I sit down with them, we kind of map things out. We do. We want to have a look and feel. I always say your website is like your business card, and social media is your handshake or your hub. And so it's very personable, there's a look and a feel and all that. So there's some more planning involved in that. And when I am managing different clients, we kind of talk through what events do you have coming up, what new menu items, or what's going on in the community. I think sharing, it's not just about us, it's this event or whatnot, just supporting other people in the community, the 4th of July parade or whatever. So we just kind of pull that things out like that, but I don't use the scheduling app and plan a bunch of stuff because life happens, I know that, and just have to be flexible.
Now, you've already shared a lot of advice, but do you have any other advice that you give to this crew here about social media and branding?
Let's see, it can feel really big and crowded and loud, and I've been revisiting that myself. It's easy, I get it, to think someone else is already doing it, someone else is already saying that. And a good friend of mine reminded me of this, and I just want to remind you that your voice isn't being heard, and the world does need your voice. The world does need your product and your why and your purpose, especially in our community, and it can feel like it's a small town and there's not enough. There's plenty of room for you. And so, kind of getting out of our head and just believing that you are here on purpose, and you can influence your community, your family, and the lives around you. So, I would just kind of get out of that and get into social media. I think it is very important not to waste your time, absolutely, because it can totally be a time waster. I've done that, especially as what I do and engaging, and time can go by. So I think we all need to keep that in check. But it is, in my opinion, very important to have social media presence and to show up and be vulnerable, to share the mishaps, to be human. And also champion other businesses. I love what you guys did today. Just hosting this and just giving information away. And I think for us to keep things so tight, I'm not going to give away this trade secret. It's a blessing to be a blessing. And so I would just leave with that and just share and give back and love people and just
comes down to creating a color palette. Like, that's what you start with. And you need to sit down and say, like, okay, what's my brand? Like, what's the color? What do I want to, when people go to Instagram, what is it going to look like? Is there going to be a consistent, like, blue color or whatever? You know, I know that sounds funny, but it's very artistic. You have to kind of create this world that people are going into, so that when they come to your TikTok page or your Instagram page or whatever it is, it's all what you're creating. So I think that's really key. I also think it's really important to be on TikTok right now because the algorithm is different. Like, you can create a massive following on TikTok overnight. Like, if you're really doing it and you're creating like a specific niche, like whatever it is, even if you're an insurance agent, like, and you're just providing value to people, people will find you and follow you because the algorithm is so unique and different. Like, for example, we had Set Active, I don't know if anyone knows who that is, they're a clothing brand out of Los Angeles. They found us on TikTok, and they came and did a whole photo shoot with our Clydesdales. Like, that's insane. And paid to do it. So, like, that's pretty incredible. We have Dana Boots coming out, who's going to have a whole retreat with us, and that's going to be really cool. And then also, Wildest is going to do a photography retreat with some big high-end photographers. So, I think being out there for my brand and my company is really important. For other companies, maybe it's not, but that's kind of what we're trying to do. So I would say number one is get on TikTok and create a color palette and create a consistency to your look and image online.
Do the three of you have anything else that you want to share? Last little tidbits? Yes.
Sorry, one last thing. I think it's really important to incorporate video, of course. I know everyone talks about that, but like really doing video and doing it well is super key. So you shouldn't be afraid to get in front of people, just as you are here right now. Get in front of people on social media if you're trying to build a brand online, and do it with video because that's how people are gonna really know you. And people are quirky, we're all quirky and fun. So why not just kind of be yourself and be authentic?
Do you have questions, Dave?
Are you done with this part? I can do that. Okay, so I have something to follow that. So real quick, I'm not on the camera, so I'm walking over here. Did anybody else want to give their why? Because we're going to give the book away, and these guys are going to pick. So some of you didn't. You have a few more seconds. Okay, go ahead.
My name is Simone, and I own the Red Poppy Gluten-Free Bakery in Capsule. And my why is we provide people with, there's a need out there for gluten-free product because people have a true allergy or nervous, sorry. they have, really true reactions to gluten, and so our product is, it provides for people that have true medical issues, and we try to be really good product so that they can be happy with what they come away with, and I started the business because I'm gluten-free, and I love making people happy with food.
Okay, we'll do one more just so we don't get carried away to you and the last opportunity.
Hi, my name is Leanna Troche. I am a speaker and transformational coach. And I guide community leaders, athletes, families through national stigma on mental health and substance abuse. And so my why is really guiding people to be the change they want to see in the world by starting with themselves. And it's a big passion of mine just through my own experience. I can hope I get to share with people and stand on stage and do workshops and retreats to help people to find some hope within themselves when the world sometimes can
parts. I'm still in the infant stages of both my businesses. One's going to be part nonprofit, one's going to be for profit. My why for this is that we know that Flathead Valley, there's been an increase in teenage suicide rates. We've also seen an increase in drug and alcohol addiction. And along with that is domestic violence rates increasing and homelessness. A lot of that goes with inflation. Some of that has to do, again, with inflation, both parents working, two or three jobs sometimes, they're not home, the kids are just kind of flailing. I know this firsthand because I have three children who are now grown, but growing up, I was relocated, my name was changed due to domestic violence. My kids kind of fell along the wayside. They were provided wraparound services, but it only lasted for 6 months. That left them with no place to go. My youngest child, thank goodness, when I had moved for the second to the last time, there was a place I had lived on Whitby Island at the time, but there was a place called The Hub. It was this little coffee shop in the commons. It trained her with customer service skills and provided wraparound services, you know, where they could just go and hang out, they could meet with a counselor. So that's going to be the nonprofit portion. The for-profit portion is because I still have to make a living too. So I do have my business name picked out. I found a location. Unfortunately, the person doesn't want to sell except for $645,000 for something that still needs to be redone. It has knob and tube, asbestos, you name it, so I'm still searching. But I want it to be close to both the junior high and high school. I do have a therapist that has agreed to come on board and work with the kids, and then I can provide them with the skills for customer service. They can work there, they can keep their tips, they can, you know, learn how to be happy. It would have pinball machines that they can come, they can escape that lifestyle and just kind of get, you know, a cup full of love from both the community as well as giving those skills needed. So that's it.
Okay, so a lot of different people gave different responses to why. So if you three could deliberate while I'm talking for a few seconds on what you've heard, you're going to pick the winner of the book. In a few moments, we're going to have a breakout session for the ones who want to stay, get a little work done today. Just a way to not lose the opportunity at the moment, not tended to take a long time. So if you want to then stay for that, you need to run off to work just quietly, run off to work, and then the rest of you can stay. We're going to have our guests help out with that. Also, as a free gift, Anoush, who gave that great presentation at the beginning, a couple points I want to make real quick. One, this is our third year of hiring a young person to work for the summer at Black Diamond Mortgage. Highly recommend if you own a business and you're old like me, that you do this, because they are bringing things to the table that I'm like, wow. And so Anoush has been doing our TikTok for a couple weeks. And she takes mortgage, and she's not even had a mortgage yet, and she's trying to make it interesting to young people. And when I see what she produces, I'm like, okay, I would have never thought of doing that. and so we had a young guy out of BYU come up for the summer and do a whole bunch of this, and we were like, wow, these young people are so smart. And then Anoush actually came to Black Diamond, and she's like, I want a job for the summer. And I said, well, why don't you write down what you want the job to say that you did at the end of the summer, and then if we agree on it, you can do it. So she's been doing that. So the way it pertains to you is she has about a month left, and you can have an hour of Anoush's time on Black Diamond's time by just scheduling it with her before you walk out the door today. So if you want that and you like what you saw, schedule an hour with Anoush, and you can come down to Black Diamond Mortgage and strategize. You saw what she did with Duke, you know, the furniture store in a short window, so you probably could benefit from it. Do we have a winner? Or did you guys just listen to me go all back? All right, I'm going to Maria, who's going to explain how we're going to do the breakout session and then announce the winner.
Gal.
love your product, by the way, because I have allergies too, and too often you go to restaurants and they think it's just that bad, and it just bugs the crap out of me. Thank you for your product. All right, so breakout session. Ideally, I'd love to have you be with people that you don't know. So we're kind of in tables right now, but I'd like you to have three to four people. Two of you can know each other, but you can't know the other two, okay? So get in groups of three to four, and what I really want you guys to do is start talking about your why. I don't want it to be, I help people get a house. That is not your why. You are a caterer, or you're a chef. Like, that's not your why. So just, I want you to get in those groups, and then what we're gonna do is we're just gonna, between Dave and I, and Anoush, and our three panelists, we're just gonna walk around and help get you guys talking about your why. I want everyone to leave here today with their why.